I'm quite sympathetic to religion in a sense. I feel as though it does serve some basic part of the human mind that, like they used to say about Heineken, it reaches the places that other beers can't reach,
yeah,
or something.
True, yeah.
Religion is a bit like Heineken in that way.
Okay, I'll tell Jesus.
A little Dutch angle for you there.
In de documentaire My Scientology Movie richt Louis Theroux zijn pijlen op de omstreden kerk en diens gevreesde roerganger David Miscavige.
You can't see where I'm calling. What is my name? Yeah.
Hello. Did you want to see the permit?
One is from England. I know he's a BBC reporter. I have no idea his name.
Louis.
Louis?
Louis.
If the church had granted you 30 minutes, one-on-one, mm-hmm. with David Miscavige, what would your first question have been?
I would have said, there are credible reports from multiple individuals who worked closely with you for years and years that you have assaulted, slapped, beaten and attacked members of your staff. How do you respond?
Dive straight in.
Yeah.
Would you have gotten away with it?
Normally, I build rapport, it's about relationship building, but you said 30 minutes, right? You can't mess around, you've got to get in there and ask the questions. You know, his personal power is such, he's a unique figure today, even among religions. You know, even the Pope has to answer to the College of Cardinals, right? And there are checks and balances on someone like the Archbishop of Canterbury. There are bishops that he has to sort of keep on board, and there are synods that he holds. So far as I'm aware, David Miscavige is basically accountable to no one. He's almost like a figure from ancient Rome, in my mind.
So how sad is it that you were not allowed access to him?
I had more than 10 years to get used to the idea of not being inside, because the first time I approached them for a TV program was in 2002, and had conversations, and they took meetings and with me, and I took a tour of the Celebrity Center in LA, but even then I had the sense that actually they don't let people in. It just runs against the grain of everything they believe to let a kind of skeptical-minded journalist have decent access inside the church. It's not how they...
So why continue?
Why continue? Well, that's what I mean, I didn't. In a sense, I didn't, because 10 years went by. I mean, I said, you know...
So this is not for me. Okay,
I'll move on. I moved on. I made, 20 or 30 or maybe 40 more programs. I can't remember how many, but there was a lot of water under the bridge. And then I got approached by Simon Chin, the producer of various prestigious
documentaries
like that, and Man on Wire. And he said, let's make a movie, and what about Scientology?
Okay, the road's closed, you're trespassing, and you need to leave.
Apparently it's a public road.
No, it isn't.
And
the
we have
road
a.
Is, no, you don't.
But can I just show you the permit?
No, it isn't. It isn't a public road.
Look,
it's
Catherine. Catherine,
look, you're not that stupid.
Whoa, whoa, you're assaulting
me. See that
me.
Thing? It says road closed.
Look.
No, look.
Look.
Come
no.
here. Come here.
Let me show you.
No, come on. What's
no, please.
Your name? Louis.
Louis.
Louis. Louis. Look. Are you so stupid you cannot see the sign that says road closed?
But look,
is there anything about that that you don't understand? Closed.
Look, well, look, I've got a permit.
Do you know what
with
a
name
road on? Means? It's closed.
How did you get Marty Rathbun, one of the most outspoken ex-members mm-hmm. of Scientology, on board?
Well, that I want to give credit to my director, John Dower, because he talked to Marty and convinced him that this was a project worth doing. Marty has done other documentaries, and he appears in Alex Gibney's film Going Clear, and he's been in other things. I think he's also aware that he probably gets approached to do so many things, he's a little burned out on the subject. But John explained the idea of the reenactments, you know, this idea that we hit on of using actors and filming it all in and around LA, and actually somehow using the filmmaking process to try to recreate a sense of what Scientology is like. All of that appealed to Marty. I think he felt, well, I don't want to do another sit-down interview and just talk about my experiences, but if what you're doing is different, if, you know, this idea of casting someone to play David Miscavige and casting someone to play Tom Cruise and then using these kind of role-play exercises to recreate scenes from inside Scientology, that he liked.
At one point, there's this great scene, and he lashes out at you. He says, fuck you.
Mm-hmm.
But you remain cool, and you mm-hmm. just say, I consider myself fucked.
He goes, you're a fucking asshole. That's a fact. Fuck you. And I go, okay, I consider myself fucked. Can we move on now?
How can you remain so cool?
I felt bad.
About doing that to him?
In the moment, I did, yes. I saw a man who was in pain and who I'd just, I'd made him, he was upset and I'd made him more upset, and...
Why didn't you say sorry? Bad television? Or the stuff that doesn't go through your mind?
I'm not sure if I didn't say sorry. If I didn't say it, and I'm aware that, because I went back and looked at it, because I was under the impression that I had, but I went back and looked at it, and when I watched the film again, I realized I hadn't said sorry. I just said, all right, I consider myself fucked. Can we move on now? I don't know where we go now. It was something like that. I wish I'd said sorry.
We don't want to create any issue for you.
And I don't want him filming me, so tell him to stop.
Well, you're filming us.
Tell him to
stop. What, you tell him to stop?
Tell him to stop.
You tell him to stop and I'll tell him to stop. How about that?
Stop.
Tell him to stop.
Louis, you need to leave.
Catherine, we don't need to leave.
Yes, you do.
Catherine, we
you're
don't.
You're trespassing.
We're not,
well,
Catherine.
You're not trespassing now. You can stay
all right.
here all night.
Thank you, Catherine. Catherine, what are you angry about? You know, my deep desire is actually to speak to someone from the
right.
Sea Org.
Oh,
so you're actually
right.
you're
oh,
actually
Louis.
Doing
oh,
me a quite
yeah.
a big favor
you're
by
like,
being
oh,
here.
Oh yeah, you're so honest. Is oh yeah, yeah. You take
so,
the stars.
So this is good. Like, let's just keep the conversation going.
Yeah, we're done. Bye, Louis.
What? Don't you don't have to go. You're not trespassing.
Wait till the police come.
We'd like you to stay, Catherine.
Do you feel protected by the camera? Moments like that?
I didn't feel I needed the camera's protection. I didn't imagine that, at least in any physical sense. I mean, what the camera does, it affords you a kind of, a sense of, well, there's a sense of performance that we're here, you know, we're having a kind of nice conversation, but we're both aware, I think, that this is being taped and that as much as we're having an organic conversation, we're enacting a certain role, and the role is to, you know, it's various, but it's for me to talk about my film, it's for you to do a good job of getting your questions answered, and I think that what the camera does, it sort of focuses and heightens what you're doing, and it gives you a permission to behave in a slightly different way than you would normally.
True, but just look at the scenes outside Gold Base, mm-hmm. with you and Andrew Perez, mm-hmm. who's a fantastic Miscavige, by the mm-hmm. way. I think he is genuinely scared at that moment, and you're not. Is
right.
that the power That's... of the camera?
You know, I was surprised he was scared. He did seem a bit nervous. And one of my...
Very good for the film, by the way.
One of the favorite bits for me in the film is where a guy comes and goes, you're trespassing, you need to leave, I'm calling the cops, right? He sounds a bit Dutch, that guy, did he to you?
No, he doesn't.
And then Andrew Perez, who plays Miscavige, says, can we go? Are we allowed to leave? And I'm like, allowed to leave? That's what they want. But he's like, oh, we better stay so that we can be arrested. And, you know, I guess it was a fairly intense situation, but, you know, I'm there to do a job, which is to try and reveal the truth and also create good moments for the film. And so I was excited to have them there. I wasn't scared. No, I was excited.
Can we talk to you? Are you in the Sea Org as well? Are you making a documentary as well? And if so, who is your one for?
Did making this film change you?
Change me?
Yes.
It changed me in as much as it was a big risk, saying we're going to do this even though they're not going to play ball with us. And it feels like, to me, it feels as though it worked. And I'm really pleased that we took the risk, and I feel more confident about moving on to other challenges. You know, I don't want to sound all sort of weird, but it was an exciting thing, and I feel it changed me in as much as how I work, how I think about my ability to do stories,
but not personally, in terms more professionally.
I suppose one other thing, which is that I'm also
you're considering. Am I going to tell him?
No. I'm trying to think. That was very good. Well, what it is that because it's, you know, I do try and see the stories that I do as a win-win in a sense. Like in the past, I've always tried to go into stories thinking we can tell the truth, make a great program, I'll be happy, and you'll be happy. Right? That you have nothing to fear from the truth. And that in a way it may even be liberating for you, and that in a way you have agreed to let me in to tell the truth about, to make a documentary about San Quentin or the porn industry or the Westboro Baptist Church because you want to tell the truth, right? That's my assumption. Now, it doesn't always happen. People get pissed off. Sometimes they don't like the films that I make. But I always hope that it will come out and be a positive result. This was a different way of working, and for the first time, I went into it fairly sure that they'd be pissed off with whatever I did. And I'm also aware that they're a powerful, as much as they are a fringe religion in a sense, they don't have that many members, they are very rich, they're capable of being confrontational and even vindictive. You know, they have a policy of wanting to shatter and suppress people they regard as enemies. And there were times when that, both during filming and afterwards, when that felt frightening for me. And so there was an enormous amount of stress at times.